Good afternoon, and welcome to a panel discussion on what humanists can bring to interfaith dialogue. Before we start, would you please turn off all your electronic devices, with the exception of hearing aids and pacemakers? I know you have to be specific with this crowd. We humanists frequently have trouble with religiously derived words and phrases. Faith is one of those words. Roy Speckhard, in his recent book, Creating Change Through Humanism, which is available at the bookstore, by the way, said that for a humanist, faith doesn't involve anything supernatural. What it really involves is a deep sense of confidence and trust. And it's in that spirit, whoops, that's another one of those words. It's in that sense that I think we can say, well, I have the faith that we will learn a lot from the panel today. And so without any further ado, I'd like to introduce Paula Rochelle, who's also been a humanist for 35 years and has served on the board of the AHA in the 1990s, and she will introduce the rest of the panel.
Good afternoon. So last October, 10,000 people from around the world gathered in Salt Lake City to attend the Parliament of the World's Religion, and we were there, as well as a couple of other people that I know are in the audience that were there. Think about it. Would you go to a place where they were talking about religion? Raise your hand if you'd be a little reluctant to go. A little reluctant. I was dubious too, thinking this might be about the big questions of life. You know those big questions, where do we come from? Why are we here? Where are we going? Those big religious questions. This was the Parliament of the World's Religions, after all. But by the second day, I was an enthusiastic attendee, and here's how that happened. The theme of the Parliament, and this was the guidebook, just so you see how dense it was reclaiming the heart of our humanity, working together for a world of compassion, peace, justice, and sustainability. And how did that all play out? With 4 days of sessions on the Parliament-defined critical issues of war, violence, and hate speech. That was one issue. Climate change and care for the earth, the second issue. Poverty, hunger, and the widening wealth gap. That was the third issue. There was a women's gathering on day one. What did I do? It's for the women's gathering. There were plenary sessions for the emerging leaders, who are the young people, and peace activist women, and the presence of indigenous peoples everywhere. From the opening ceremony, where the indigenous people in their full regalia, these were the Utes from Utah, the Shoshone and several others, welcomed us to their land for this conference. There was also a teepee outside the main entrance, where each day we were welcomed with a chant and a fire, even in the rain. So, what's not to like? Everything at the Parliament of World Religions was focused on this life, this world, and how we are to live together with compassion, peace, justice, and sustainability. Sounds like a humanist event to me. There was art and music, dance, singing, food, community. It was a full-body humanist experience every session I attended focused on this life and how to live and thrive together. I heard about the issues of living on earth from birth to burial and nothing before or beyond. Sounded very humanistic to me. And what were those issues that we were focused upon? Peace in the Middle East, indigenous peoples, dining with discretion, citizen diplomacy, climate change, poverty and income inequality, women's rights, and many more. So what did I experience at this parliament in Salt Lake City? One of the sessions was a cosmic mass celebrating our common humanity on an endangered earth with Matthew Fox. Listening from the heart, a workshop practice for deep connection with a stranger, and a free lunch daily offered by the Sikh community for 10,000 people. I visited with nuns and natives. I saw musical performances that included dancers from Brazil, drummers from the Pacific Islands, and school children from Salt Lake City. I visited a cavern of booths. One speaker called it an airplane hangar, selling religious baubles, beads, and books, and ideas and ideals. And that's where I found Mel Whitman, because he was at the AHA board giving out humanist literature, and we've put copies at the back, which he'll tell you about that, until he ran out. He was cheerfully and deliberately talking with people about humanism. He'll get into that. And where would you find Rebecca Armstrong? Dancing at the Cosmic Mass, mingling with the artists, some of whom were her dear friends, delighting in her son's company. He was there with her. And Ben Wade was just in awe of the many sessions with too many choices to make good choices on subjects that he cared about but hadn't heard enough about in humanist circles. So we're going to hear from each of the panelists this morning and then have time for questions. There's a little intro about each of them in your booklet, so I'm not going to repeat what's in your booklet. So for the order of them is Rebecca Armstrong, who's a humanist celebrant, scholar, and my personal mentor. Then Ben Wade, who's a longtime humanist activist and supporter, followed by Mel Lipman, the former president of the AHA. What was he doing at the Parliament of World Religions? Please help me welcome Rebecca Armstrong. Rebecca.
Well, Paula has told you what is in store for humanists if they involve themselves in an interfaith religious conference. I'm going to turn the tables and suggest a reason why it is that the interfaith community needs the humanists. And in fact, this subtext of our panel today could be unexpected allies. And I want to take you back to 1993, which was the first parliament that I attended, not having sadly been around for the 1893 parliament. I was there representing the humanist scholar and mythologist Joseph Campbell. Among the people that I had invited, the religious scholars that I had invited under that umbrella, was Chongyang El Huang, the Tai Chi master, Chinese artist, and follower of Taoism. And when the call went out to the religious leaders that they were seeking for about 120 out of the 8,000 participants to be involved in something called Declaration Toward a Global Ethic, we sent Chongyang El Huang as our representative. Now, we've just heard a wonderful talk about the importance of humility. So let me frame for you the situation in 1993, where 120 world religious leaders are in a room with Hans Kung straight from the United Nations saying, "We want you to frame a declaration toward a global ethic that will be one of the standard guides for the United Nations to use in determining the values of the planet." And the religious leaders are so excited. They have triumphed over the things that divide. And the first statement of the first speaker is how wonderful it is that we've all found common ground. That in spite of the fact that we have different names for God, we are all here because we believe in God. And there's an uncomfortable murmuring in the back of the room. And several Native American elders stand up and say, "Please forgive us for so rudely interrupting, but we cannot start with that as a foundation. You have dictated what our religion looks like in your own words and pictures, but it is not so. We are a non-theistic tradition." And then Chung Liang El Wang stood up. He said, "I was invited here to represent the Tao. The Tao is not a god. It's not a theistic tradition. Taoism is a very nature-based, natural philosophy of life." One after another, members of that small group stood up and said, "I'm sorry, but I am not a theist, and yet I haven't been invited here. I am sitting at this table. Do you want to include me or not?" And in the moment of triumph, the religious leaders had to back down and become very humble and say, "We're sorry. We made an assumption that we were all believers in God, even with different names. We now see that even that was too limiting." And they did go on to produce a document that is one of the most beautiful humanistic documents that has no mention of God. This is a product of the Parliament of World Religions, which accepted at the very beginning that there are ways to be good and do good in the world that do not rely and will not be founded upon the insistence of a divine creator. That is the first reason why we should become familiar with our unexpected allies. Now let me return to Joseph Campbell for a minute, because I want to give you, as clearly as I can, the reason I believe that humanists are absolutely essential to the ongoing dialogue of interfaith. Joseph Campbell attended a conference once that was trying to unite two other domains, two disciplines, mythology and psychology. And the great psychologist James Hillman stood up at one point and made the remark, "You know, listening to Joseph Campbell is very disconcerting, because it's not that he knows more than any of us, it's that he knows more than all of us." And by that, what he meant was, we, psychologists, mythologists, religious experts, are knowledgeable about one small thing, and we know a lot about it very deeply. But Joseph Campbell was a generalist. He made it his point to know a lot about a lot of different things. And because of that, he moved to another level, a metacognitive level, where he could see not just the specifics of different religious beliefs, but he could begin to see what Gregory Bateson described as the pattern that connects, which is why Joseph Campbell was able to say, all of these religious mythologies have their basis in biology. They are a psychological expression of the biological urges of Homo sapiens throughout time and around cultures, which is why they are also startlingly similar when you peel off the outer layer. It was that insight of Campbell's that made his work so stunning and exciting to so many religious and non-religious persons. Why is that important? It is because we as humanists are also generalists in the sense that we can see the forest because we are not aligned with any single tree. Now, I'm not just saying that as a hope or a wish. I can actually back that up with evidence. In 2010, the Pew Charitable Trust did this, one of their big, deep research projects, to see what Americans actually know about religion. And the results were astounding. It turns out that the group that knows more facts about religion than any other group are the atheists. But do you see why? It's because you don't have to embed yourself in one single compartment. If you see the thing as a whole, you begin to grasp certain ideas, certain patterns, certain structures that inform everything. So at this time of global crisis, when every voice is needed at the table, it is a grand mistake to think that we are fighting religious people. We have extraordinary allies. We need to understand how to talk with them and what our role is, what our true voice is in that ongoing dialogue. So I invite you to take the meta level. Look at the forest. Don't get caught in the trees of dissent and conflict. Allow yourself to be part of the bigger conversation.
Good afternoon, everyone. I really appreciate this opportunity to share my experience as a long-term humanist at the Parliament of the World's Religions. And I must admit that when I registered to attend the Parliament and put my money and time on the line, I had a lot of misgivings. As a lifelong humanist and member of many humanist atheist organizations, I was fearful and concerned that the main subject and theme of the conference would be about religion and God. When this turned out not to be the case, I was surprised and delighted. In fact, the conference activities that I attended did not even mention God or religion, but focused on important secular issues and problems that I could easily relate to, as they were the issues and problems that I, as a humanist, were concerned with. In addition, I was really surprised and pleased to notice that some of the topics addressed were those that we in the humanist community ignore or even are reluctant to tackle, like the Israeli-Palestinian problem, food choices relative to environment and health, and personal growth, such as compassion and empathy. At first, I was wondering, what am I doing here? And would I feel comfortable and accepted as a non-believer? However, after a few hours, I realized that this was an atmosphere of total acceptance of each other as humans, seeking solutions to very difficult problems. I soon became excited and enthused by the prospects of myself as a humanist to be able to work together with many, many, many others of common mind and goodwill to solve problems that we all knew were important and needed the cooperation of all. Attendance at this conference of about 10,000 people attests to the strength of the interstate movement, and it is a movement. Participants included Christians of many denominations, Buddhists, Jews, Islamists, pagans, humanists, and people of many other philosophical beliefs and spiritual paths. Not only were there people of many faiths, but as well those of many age groups, including young people and participants from all over the globe. Truly, this is an international movement. I felt that all were welcome, and I was struck by the willingness and energy of attendees to work with others of all backgrounds for solutions to common problems. Problems such as poverty, war, civil rights, justice, and the environment. Let me share with you from our book, from the Parliament, called The Commitment Book. And just one of the commitments has to do with an interfaith call to action. Action, the important word, on climate change. And it goes on to say, because the climate crisis is unprecedented in its scale and complexity, no single government, institution, or religion can bring about the urgently needed solutions. Action is needed at all levels, personal, local, national, regional, and international. As members of religious and spiritual communities, we affirm these values and principles, which are taught by our traditions and will guide our actions. Number one, we are profoundly interconnected with nature, on which we depend for our existence. We must respect and care for nature and all of life. We uphold the dignity and rights of every human being. We must provide for the needs and well-being of all people. We must act with love and compassion and for justice and fairness. We are morally responsible for our chosen actions. We have duties to future generations who will bear the consequences of our actions or our inactions. We commit ourselves to take action and to act together as one human community. At this conference, one of the important things I witnessed was the total absence of anyone pushing any particular faith or religious dogma. I enjoyed the prevalence of song, dance, and performance by adults and children of many backgrounds. It was particularly rewarding to have Medea Benjamin, our own 216 AHA humanist heroine, participating. She champions international human rights and social justice through the organizations she co-founded, Code Pink and Global Exchange. To my way of thinking, humanists would be making a huge mistake not to join and actively participate in the interfaith movement. I decided to put my long-standing fears and prejudices against members of faith, religion, and belief aside and become a member and active supporter of this movement. Interfaith, to my mind, is the way of thoughtful activists in the 21st century. Humanists alone are a very small number in the great scheme of things. And to think that we can solve the monumental problems of the 21st century by ourselves is naive. Why not join with other similar purpose people in solving at least lessening some of the most pressing problems of the modern world, and lend our considerable talent and knowledge as well from our secular view to finding solutions? In my opinion, the future is tending towards our philosophy of life, so why not give it our support and demonstrate to others that humanists are friendly, respectful, and effective members of an interfaith movement to find solution to human problems? After all, isn't that our highest calling as humanists?
The American Humanist Association's booth at the Parliament of World Religions had a large banner that read, "Good without a God." This was enough to get a large number of attendees to stop by the booth to find out who we were and what were we doing at a gathering of religions. And it provided us with a great opportunity to communicate with like-minded people who completely agreed with us on issues such as climate change and world peace and general goodness. At our booth and on the panel which we were invited to participate in, we explained that interfaith work did not mean relinquishing the distinctiveness of one's own tradition of faith or belief to reach a common denominator. We spoke of how people of most religious faiths or none can engage in creating a civil society through cooperation as well as critical and self-critical encounter with one another. And we made the point that if we stand for the same values, we will be stronger together than apart. Groups such as ISIS or the Westboro Baptist Church were, of course, not represented at the parliament, and they would be opposed to any interfaith involvement. Similarly, there are atheist groups who would oppose any interfaith involvement. Just as some religious individuals make it their sole mission to convert others to their faith, many atheists engage with people of faith solely in the hopes of convincing them to abandon their beliefs. But there are also atheists who are willing to listen and to share, to dialogue and to learn. They are part of a growing population of people who don't believe in gods, but still want the same things everybody else wants, meaning community and a better world. Many of the core beliefs of the various faiths centers around moral living, putting good out in the world as opposed to evil or bad. We may not all agree on each and every issue or cause, but there is plenty in the name of goodwill, good moral living that we could all come together on and work on. The more the atheist community moves beyond purely philosophical debates to embrace the practical pursuit of justice, the more we can establish a reputation for ourselves as a force for good in the world. The religious and the secular communities have to get rid of the ridiculous idea that we are inherently antagonistic. I probably have more shared beliefs with a liberal religionist than I do with many militant atheists. We must listen to each other in a cooperative rather than an adversarial atmosphere. An emphasis on values and ethics could focus attention away from doctrine and dogma to shared vision. Focusing only on our differences serves only to separate and to polarize people. If we are to solve global problems such as climate change and wars, we must shift from a paradigm of separateness to one of unity by evolving from an emphasis on doctrines that separate to values that unite. If people from different backgrounds knew each other and have listened carefully enough to understand where the other person is coming from and work together for a common cause, then it becomes almost impossible to demonize the other. That doesn't mean they will agree on everything, but once trust has been established, it is possible to articulate conflicting views on controversial issues while still maintaining mutual respect. Coming together to pursue peace, justice, equality, and all other values we hold together is essential if we don't want to dismiss friends and allies on a wide variety of issues simply because of theistic beliefs. In Las Vegas, Nevada, I'm a longtime board member of the Interfaith Council, and I agree that interfaith may not be the best description. Groups around the country have been changing the name to interbelief and other such more inclusive terms. In Las Vegas, we have recently amended our bylaws after my pushing for several years. We've amended the bylaws to change our description from, quote, various faith communities to various faith, philosophical, and cultural communities. So we are now a full part of the organization. The fundamental misunderstanding that many atheists have is that they imagine that the interfaith movement is uninterested in combating religious totalitarianism and that they exist solely to maintain religious privilege as an excuse to show that religion has a monopoly on morality. But that could not be further from the truth. Interfaith work exists to bring diverse religious and non-religious people into common work to build relationships that might deconstruct the kind of us versus them thinking. It's a place to challenge and to question, but to do so constructively. Gar Jameson, who's the current chair of the Interfaith Council of Southern Nevada, wrote, quote, "In a world in which we have technologically gained the capacity to destroy the planet many times over, the expansion of interfaith understanding becomes not only a privilege, but a duty to every person of this beleaguered planet. No longer can we afford the exclusive attitudes of medieval times in which other traditions were viewed with not only suspicion but disdain. There is great confusion about our diverse spiritual perspectives. It is a goal of interfaith understanding to break down all barriers of prejudice, bias, and bigotry in order to promote universal appreciation and celebration of our diversity, unquote. As a humanist, I believe that we can learn from people who have different experiences and different beliefs. Interfaith cooperation not only harmonizes our differences and lessens suspicions between communities, it teaches us that we are better together. I don't believe any supernatural force will solve our problems, and it will be up to all of us to work together to address human problems. And as Chris Stedman, director of the Yale University Humanist Community and the author of Faithiest, has said, quote, "We may not agree on the existence of a God or an afterlife, but surely we can agree that life in the here and now requires that we create peaceful, collaborative ways to work and to live together. I call on those in humanist communities to join interfaith movements back home, and feel free to call on me or several other people for advice on how to get into those communities and how to set those up. In conclusion, we need to stop focusing on what makes us different, like beliefs, and start focusing on what makes us the same. As one human community, we can search together for ways to make this a better world. Thank you.
So we have copies of the Global Ethic here. We didn't hand them out ahead of time because we knew humanists like to read, and you would read them while we are talking. And now's the time for the Q&A. Is it safe to pass them out now? I don't know. Is it safe? All right. And at the back of the room, the literature that Mel handed out under that sign that said, "Good without a God," was all this literature that the AHA provided. So it's back there on two trays as you're leaving, or, you know, it has titles like, "Are you a Catholic? You may also be a humanist. Are you a pagan? You may also be a humanist. Are you a Hindu? You may also be a humanist. Are you a Christian? Are you a Sikh? Are you a Unitarian? Are you a Quaker? Are you an atheist?" This is the literature that by the second day, I think it was gone, right, Mel? And more, he drove. Anyway, so it's time for a Q&A, but so if we pass out the booklets now, you will still listen, right? Yeah. Okay, so we'll come down and pass them out, but please, it's time for Q&A, and Mel is our master Q&A-er, so here he is.
Oh, dear.
Go right ahead.
Yeah, I find myself religiously opposed to cooperating with religion. I mean, honestly, I get this really tight feeling in my stomach when I think about it. And I guess probably because I was raised Catholic in the 50s and 60s, and I eventually left in the 70s. And you know, we in the Catholic Church, of course, they have liberation theology and all that jazz. And it's just like, yeah, we'll tolerate you when you're way out here, but, you know, when things get better and we get more in power, you know, your history. So I really, I agree cognitively that we do have to work together to solve the very serious and huge problems that we are confronting because of what we've done to the earth and what we've done to each other. But I see religion as the root of that, not as a solution for that.
If you spoke with people on the Interfaith Council, they don't believe the way the way you just described. And I agree with you that the Catholic Church and other churches have historically been anti-atheist. But the interfaith movement is not made up of any of those people. Somebody like Craig Hicks, who killed the Muslims in Chapel Hill, identified as an atheist, but you wouldn't relate to him as far as hating religious people the way he did. And it's the same way the religious people involved in the interfaith movement don't see atheists in the kind of light that some of the extremists do.
I was fortunate enough to go to the parliament this last year, and I'm a humanist and atheist, and I'm a strong interfaith advocate. But there, I find myself with limitations, and while I was there, I realized, I had a really hard time with it, seeing that the Scientologists had a booth at the interfaith at the parliament, and so I wrestle with this idea of religious being a religious pluralist, and so I've kind of come up with like, well, maybe I'm religious plural-ish, you know, because I realize that there's like, as far as like the table that I would like to have people at to have these interfaith discussions, how far am I really willing to push who is involved? Because I did feel comfortable. I loved the parliament, and it was an amazing experience. And of all the people that I came away with a good friendship with was an evangelical Christian, which was very, very surprising to me. And we talked, and we did have so much in common. It was unbelievable. But so I would wonder what you would say to that idea of inclusiveness. How inclusive should you be? And I also wanted to ask your thoughts on this sort of the language within the brochures that you might be a humanist. Is that diminishing the deeply held views of these other religions by saying, yeah, you're a Christian, but you're probably a humanist? Do you feel like that there's any way that language might be dismissive of right. someone else's
no,
faith?
No, when you read the brochures, it doesn't say you are a humanist, but it leads you to believe that you can be a Christian, but you could still think like a humanist. You can be a Muslim, but you could still think like a humanist in all these different respects. Read the wording of the booklet and you'll see. As far as your first comment, and I agree, it's uncomfortable when you have Scientologists at an interfaith council meeting. We when you have groups from the Unification Church and other churches who are very opposed to your ideas, when you're fighting for transgender rights and you have a lot of Mormons on the interfaith council who are opposed to it. But the point is, in order to get people to change their minds, you have to belong to the same tribe. And when you all belong to the Interfaith Council, you're all a member of the same tribe. I can talk to these Mormons about gay rights. I can talk to them about transgender rights. And they listen to me where they won't listen to me as an atheist. Okay? They'll hear my arguments, and I can make my points much better by being on an Interfaith Council. And I can get many converts, not as far as their religion, but converts as far as their ideas. I've gotten a lot of Mormons who are now pro-gay rights, okay, even though they remain Mormons, but because they would listen, they listen to reason, they listen to logic, and they listen to good arguments. So by belonging to the same tribe, you'll get people to listen to you. Okay.
Hi. I suppose the interfaith dialogue without mentioning God sounds like a good thing, first of all. But let me tell you that I was born in a family that used to identify themselves as Hindus. I don't identify myself in terms of any religion. And I'm kind of getting to be, you might say from the discussion here, anti-religion, if you forgive me for that. But here's the deal. When I look at, for instance, now, if somebody is a Muslim, do you expect him to believe in Islam or not? What is the definition of Muslim? Without believing in Islam, you cannot be a Muslim, the way I see it. Okay? Now, when I read some of these books, I see several things, four different things. One is stupidity. Second is injustice. Third is hatred. And fourth is atrocities. Okay? There are four different categories of things that people should not follow. Okay? Now, I suppose if you call yourself a Muslim, for instance, and if you reject the verses that is atrocious, that's hateful, that's injustice, I have no problem accepting you as a human being. But when you are a Muslim, you believe in Islam, and you are supposed to follow everything there, it just cannot be a human being, civilized human being. That's the plain truth of that. Now, how with that are we going to accept this so-called interfaith dialogue?
Okay.
One faith clearly hates the other faith and no faith.
One of my, it's a valid point and it's an argument I've heard many times, but you pick on Muslims, you can pick on...
No, this is one example, sorry.
Well, you can pick on devout Christians also.
Same thing, yeah, exactly. Okay. Like, for instance...
Yeah, I don't want to make this a two-way dialogue.
In the Bible, if you reject Christianity, your brother, your sister, your son, your friend...
Okay, let me respond.
They're supposed to kill him. That's the instruction.
Yeah.
Okay?
Let him answer the question.
Right. And okay, through the Interfaith Council, I've become one of my good friends in Las Vegas is the imam of the largest Muslim temple in Las Vegas. And by being a good friend, we can communicate and we can discuss things that other Muslims might take as insulting. And we get into lots of dialogue. And he believes in interpreting the Quran according to modern times. And this is an imam in the Muslim church who believes the same way liberal Christians believe in interpreting the Bible according to modern times. And the only way to get through to this person is by belonging to the Interfaith Council, by treating me as an equal, as a member of his tribe. He'll listen to my arguments. I could not make these arguments if I didn't know him, if I was a stranger. He would vigorously defend the Quran. He doesn't when we have discussions, and he doesn't when he sends out these messages to the people in his congregation or what. Okay.
Hi, my name's Debbie Williams. I'm from Houston, Texas, and as a humanist in the South, I'm so glad y'all had a good time. But let me tell you, we're not welcome at the table in our communities. And I'm getting really tired of hearing how I need to be trying harder, how I need to be working more in outreach to these people who think I'm Satan incarnate. and the reason they want to homeschool their kids so they can stay away from me.
Is this on the Interfaith Council?
Yeah, and especially in Fort Bend County where I do live, I was told by a member of a liberal Christian congregation that while they agreed with us in principle in many things, however, other people would leave if we joined. So,
did they belong to any international?
I don't know if they belong to an international
organization.
Again, there's a resistance in many areas in the South. When I lived in Memphis,
I'm talking about like the Interfaith Alliance or the National Association.
I'm not
North
sure
American
about that specific
Interfaith
group.
Network.
We are having success with a group in Houston in the city proper, but that happens in many places.
Well, I can just tell you, I've been involved in the Interfaith movement for about 15 years now, and when I first went to an Interfaith Council meeting, it was composed mainly of priests, ministers, all religious people, and when I told them I want to be a member because I'm a humanist celebrant, they wanted to know what is a humanist celebrant, and I explained, and they told me I don't belong there, this is only for Christians and Jews. And
real religious people.
Okay, I kind of pushed my way kicking and screaming onto the Interfaith Council, and it took maybe 5 years for them to get accustomed to me. And once somebody said, well, he's not really that bad, they started to listen. And it's not an easy thing, probably, in a lot of the southern communities. But if they belong to a major international head organization, which most interfaith councils do, they usually have it in their bylaws, provisions against that kind of prejudice.
So we can do it on a technicality?
Yes.
I'm asking.
Not in a technicality, but just complain about the local council that they're not operating in accordance with the bylaws of the organization they belong to.
The national yes. organization.
The national, okay. Yeah.
Well, I know you're in trouble.
Hi, Mel.
Hi.
I'm Carrie Shaw. I'm president of the Humanists and Freethinkers of Fairfield County, Connecticut. Mm-hmm. I had the great pleasure of giving an invocation at an interfaith prayer service on the grounds of a Catholic parish. It was a lot of fun. I enjoyed myself. It was well received. This was an event where leaders of the different religious communities each had a chance to provide an invocation. Jewish, Catholic, Protestant, Sikh, Hindu, a variety of others. And I was clear about it, so I was introduced as a president as opposed to a religious leader. And I just gave a simple, very positive message that related to what our wishes were as to elevate ourselves and humankind. If you want to see it, it was published by FFRF in one of their news magazines. So it was great. This was a non-governmental sponsored. This was sponsored by someone who was a Catholic priest who wanted to bring the community together. And as a final note, well, basically I wanted to encourage people, instead of agonizing over it, present yourself, participate, you'll enjoy it, it'll be good. Best wishes for all.
Thank you.
I don't have a question, but I do want to appreciate you. My name is Ann Clayson. I'm leader of the New York Society for Ethical Culture. I'm also the humanist chaplain at NYU and the humanist religious life advisor at Columbia and co-dean of the Humanist Institute. And I can tell you that being the humanist at the table in interfaith settings is a very good experience. I recently was the humanist at the table at the Council on Foreign Relations for their 10th Religion and Foreign Policy workshop, and it's very important for us to be at the table. So even if it's discouraging, please make the effort, because it's important to make these relationships with one another. It's important to give that humanist invocation, to do the humanist celebration, and so make that effort to be there. It is well worth it. I was with you guys at the Parliament of the World's Religions. My son and I went to the 2009 Parliament in Melbourne, and it's just extremely important for us to claim our place at the table. We have something to offer the world. And so come at it from that perspective, I suggest. Not that we are in opposition or conflicting, but rather we have something very important to offer. Thank you.
Thanks, Ian.
I'm from the Bible Belt of California, and we're on the front lines. We got our work cut out for us. But one of the things that I have, we've been involved 2 years in the Interfaith Council, and I'm writing up their bylaws. But being gentle and tolerant of, like, some of the people were against us joining. And also they have kind of, it's something like PTSD, or they've had a bad experience with the religion and they don't right. think that we should be part of that. I've invited them to come along to the Interfaith Council, but is there anything else we could do to make it an easier transition for them?
Well, in Las Vegas, not only do we have Interfaith Council meetings, but monthly we have forums, discussions with people of all faiths. Each month it's a different topic. There are so many ideas that you can have. My time up for it?
Well, you could finish your sentence.
Okay.
No more time. So therefore, those who have more questions for the panel, please meet them out in the lobby. The next program starts in 5 minutes.
I'll be glad to talk to anybody off mic.
Yeah, we ran out of time.